Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. Starting off with some good news, my beer supply is replenished, and thanks to those who expressed concern last week. It's a Japanese lager from Harland Brewing in San Diego. You know, I only really have a couple drinks a week these days, but if anyone wants to send more, the P.O. box is listed in the video's description. Tech news, though. Intel. Oh, Intel, how far you have fallen with continued layoffs and vultures circling. AMD plans to beat Team Blue while they're down with another family of CPUs based on Zen 6 in the process of being locked and loaded. And PC gamers finally have Nvidia right where they want them. Positioned as the most valuable publicly traded company in the world, topping $4 trillion market cap for the first time ever, their success will undoubtedly make them overconfident, and then we strike. Works every time, just like the tech news. Cheers. Excellent! Today's video is brought to you by Lexar. Their SSDs are the ideal storage solution for your next build. The NQ780 is a balanced drive that combines performance with value, offering impressive PCIe Gen 4 speeds as well as a single-sided design, SLC cache, and intelligent power control. The NM1090 Pro features blazing fast PCIe Gen 5 read speeds up to 14,000 megabytes per second, twice as fast as PCIe Gen 4. The NM1090 Pro also has a dual DRAM plus SLC cache and a 6-nanometer controller to minimize heat output even under sustained workloads. Both drives are available in capacities up to 4 terabytes and come with a 5-year warranty. For more on the Lexar NM1090 Pro and NQ780 SSDs, click the sponsor links in the video description. We begin today with Intel, the once proud chip giant who was subjected to some brutal criticism from their harshest detractors this week. Forget being in the top 3, Intel isn't even in the top 10 semiconductor companies anymore, and it's too late to catch up with the likes of Nvidia in the AI race. And these words came from Intel's CEO, Lip Bu Tan, who apparently moonlights as a tech media writer, given his rosy outlook. Tan followed up his pep talk with another morale booster by laying off thousands more employees, with the total number of positions axed still unknown, but this follows plans announced earlier in the year to trim the fat and attempt to make Intel profitable again. Intel also spun off their robotics-focused subsidiary RealSense on Friday, which will get them about $50 million in funding, but of course, no more Intel robots, which sort of goes against some other industry trends toward automation and investment in what will eventually become our robot overlords, but I guess cybernetic limbs weren't helping balance the budget in Intel's accounting department. Intel is also shutting down their automotive business, outsourcing their marketing department, and cutting up to a fifth of all jobs from their manufacturing operations. And to top it all off, their 18A process, which has been in development for years now, former CEO Pat Gelsinger's baby, is losing interest from outside customers and will likely only be used for internal Intel products, which was not what they planned. It was supposed to compete with TSMC for third-party fabless chip designers, but now Intel will need to fall back to 18A variations or the follow-up 14A node. Consumer reactions to all this bleak Intel news is mixed. While some rightfully see it as the comeuppance that was in store after Intel spent a decade or so skating by with stagnant quad-core CPU offerings while investing far more into stock buybacks and drone shows than new product R&D, it's also quite true that Intel is the only actual competition to AMD right now on the desktop CPU side of the market, and losing them would be very bad. And they're potentially the best upcoming GPU alternative to the Nvidia / AMD Radeon duopoly that has existed for far too long. Gamers Nexus did an excellent dive into the Intel Arc GPU situation this week, which is linked in the description and is well worth a watch, but there is plenty to be optimistic about with some of the info that they dug up. B580 sales volume being 5 times better than Arc Alchemist is good. Intel playing nice with board partners who want to do unique designs is cool too. And a focus on hitting good prices is also nice, even if real world retail prices are still over what they should be. The 6 to 8 month turnaround for new factory GPU orders to get to market is less ideal though, and it's interesting to hear how challenging it is for Intel to have a launch stand out when competing with launches from both AMD and Nvidia. For now, Intel Arc is still a thing though, and there's hope for the future, although it greatly depends on how Intel navigates the rest of 2025 and transitions into next year. Even the B770 rumors are still alive. We just hope that Lip Bu Tan and the executive team calling the shots over at Intel don't decide that Arc should suffer the same fate as Intel's robots. While Intel struggles, though, AMD has been carefully planning, and their next-gen CPU architecture development is already well underway. It is known as Zen 6, the somewhat predictable successor to Zen 5, and there's a lineup codenamed Olympic Ridge for desktops and Medusa Point for mobile. Apart from the fearsome monikers, the specs for Zen 6 are pretty exciting. Possibly 12 cores per CCD instead of 8, boosting core counts by up to 50%, a low-latency die-to-die bridge to reduce or eliminate latency between cores, and a newly designed double DDR5 memory controller that is still dual-channel, by the way, just to get things started. Desktop versions will thankfully still be compatible with socket AM5 if these rumors hold, and the early leaks from February have just been bolstered two times. First, by an official IDA 64 update that adds preliminary support for AMD Zen 6 desktop, server, and mobile processors. And side note, this IDA 64 update also mentions an unreleased Radeon RX 9060 non-XT video card. Interesting. And second, per Yuri Bubli, aka OneAsmus, who develops the Hydra tuning software for AMD platforms, engineering samples of Zen 6 CPUs have already been shipped to partners and motherboard manufacturers, which usually happens sometime prior to launch so motherboard manufacturers can manufacture motherboards. Mr. Bubli says Zen 6 won't be a revolution, it will be an evolution. Which is quite mysterious, but perhaps means raw performance gains will be more modest while functionality expands? Just my guess. This is also where the dual DDR5 memory controller information comes from, though. AMD is still pretty tight-lipped about Zen 6, but given the lack of competition from Intel, they have plenty of wiggle room as they finish out the product development cycle. My money is currently on a January 2026 debut at CES. And now we overclock the tech news, increasing the frequency slightly as the show continues with tech briefs. We want Intel to not suck, but it's undeniable that Intel really sucks at this, providing an upgrade path for their CPU buyers by staying with the same socket for more than one or two generations. AMD's AM4 platform has been around for almost 9 years and is compatible with at least four processor families from the 1000 to 5000 series, but Intel still seems to think one or one and a half gens is perfectly okay. It's already been rumored for months that Intel's actual next-gen CPUs, the Core Ultra 300 series, codenamed Nova Lake, will be on yet another new socket, LGA 1954, meaning their current LGA 1851 platform will be 86th after only the original Arrow Lake Core 200 series and an Arrow Lake refresh family expected later this year, as was recently alleged by ZDNet. It's rumored to target AI demand by adding an NPU, which will have dubious use for home PC applications, as well as a slight increase in operating clock, which doesn't sound optimistic when it comes to boosting gaming performance versus AMD's X3D options, or whatever Zen 6 brings to the table for that matter. And yes, there will almost certainly be Zen 6 CPUs with 3D V-cache, so we need more CPU competition from Intel. Case in point, during the big Prime Day sales this week, which I totally ignored, everyone should thank me for that, but there actually were some decent deals, but not on the 9800X3D. That dropped to $470 from $479. $9 off. No competition, no deals. Speaking of competition, last week we discussed Hardware Unboxed's findings that the RX 9070 XT has gained a good amount of performance since launch, a decent 9% by their testing. A couple other media outlets, including Brian from Tech Yes City, decided to verify this claim, and it led to some misunderstanding that borders on the dramatic, so I just wanted to clarify since I also amplified Steve's results. If you test the launch driver versus the newest driver right now, as Brian did, it results in far more modest gains depending on the game tested, or as testing games found, about a 4% boost instead of 9%. Which is because the driver isn't all that has changed. There have also been game updates, engine patches, Windows updates, and other things that could have improved since a few months ago. So the gains are still there versus launch test results. There's just more to it than just the driver. And now some video titles and headlines have been retconned to make this a bit more clear to people. So, drama averted. We don't need any more of that in the tech media world. Thank you very much. Let's finish off with a couple Nvidia stories, starting with Sovereign AI. what the f*** is sovereign AI? It's like regular AI, but with a much wealthier customer. You see, Nvidia is now pretty much the most valuable company in the world thanks to selling millions of AI chips to companies like Meta, Google, and OpenAI. But apparently, per this story, the appetite for buying Blackwell nodes that cost multiple tens of thousands of dollars each is starting to dry up. At least from businesses. Governments, on the other hand, are growing more interested in sovereign AI, or the ability to control and manipulate AI as a technology by a nation or state, which has immediately increased Nvidia's stock price because big government is apparently an even bigger potential buyer than big tech. And if your immediate follow-up question is, how will the powers that be put all this AI hardware to use? Shut up, we're not concerning ourselves with that. Surely it will be deployed for humanitarian goals to make the world a better place for all of us. So Nvidia has a bunch of new buyers, stock prices are up, but the rest is still a bit murky. Speaking of Nvidia being the most valuable company in the world, publicly traded, by market cap at least, did you know that that is how it is? And they hit a mind-boggling valuation of over $4 trillion on Wednesday, which was at least in part impacted by the aforementioned sovereign AI development. They managed to beat Apple and Microsoft to the punch, and somewhat humorously, Intel too. Not that there was much competition there. In fact, there was a point in 2005, reportedly, when Intel was thinking about buying Nvidia for $20 billion, which seems like it would have been a steal. But I think it would have just meant we got GTX 600 series refreshes for most of the 2010s alongside stagnant Intel quad cores. But anyway though, yeah, $4 trillion. It's hard to even comprehend, so I guess I'll drink to that. Cheers, $4 trillion. But there you have it, guys, tech news for the week, and if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all of the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested, and you can also check out my store at paulushardware.net for high-quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call, too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.